And there are a couple of questions here and some comments. Somebody, Vijayalakshmi, says that fresh turmeric roots chutney is yum.
Yeah, it is.
Yeah, okay. And Radha Raghavan wants to know, all spice plant locally, what is it called?
Oh, well, I don't know the local name, but I have it growing in my, I can find out and let you know, but I'm not very well versed with Canada. I'm learning the language, so I'll find out the name and let you know.
Okay. So does it grow in Karnataka? I mean, you're growing it here, but does it just grow anywhere in India? I mean,
yeah, it can grow anywhere with the right humid soil conditions.
Okay.
Just like how strawberries and stuff, which are not native to India, grow here. Similar to the same philosophies applied to the allspice plant.
Okay, fine. And Anuja Meer wants to know, how do you make aloe vera juice and how best can she use dodapatra?
Oh, dodapatra. Dodapatra is basically, you can take the leaf. The best way to have it is break it and there's a cracking sound and then just take out the leaf. That's it. Because you release the juices when you're chewing it. And that's very important for your digestion, to release the juices. You can also cook it, put it into your sambars, make an amazing chutney. Take your mortar and pestle, put rock salt, put ginger, a little bit of chili and a few peanuts and grind it into a paste. And if you want to make it more pasty, you can add a little bit of coconut oil. That'll also make it last longer. And it'll stay in your fridge for about a week and a half. And another one was aloe vera.
Yeah, aloe vera. How to make the juice.
So aloe vera is an interesting, so the thing with aloe vera is that when you break it open, this gel is what you see. The gel, right? Now this gel, if you're conversant with the plant gels, there is an external layer, which is the layer that protects the plant and which is not edible, but there is an internal layer of the gel, which is the edible part. So once we get more nuanced with understanding which gel is the edible part, you just have to take the knife, cut it open and take a spoon and scoop the gel out. And the best way to do it is scoop it out, put it in a glass of water, blend it with a spoon and another 2 spoons of water and just glug it. So it's fresh. I would suggest you get organic aloe vera and not the nursery aloe vera, because they would have used some sprays on it.
Okay. Praveen ji and Lalita Malani ji, both thank you so much. And it's beautifully presented, whatever you did. It's very informative and very motivating. And Lalita says we need to take charge of our health and life. And a lot of people are complimenting you on the beautiful talk you've given. Rashmi Munshi has a question. Please let us know how to juice without using mixer, which destroys nutrients.
So yeah, juicing is it's a controversy because there are 2 methods of juicing. There is the cold pressed way of juicing, which keeps your enzymes and your vitamins and minerals intact. Whereas the blender method, which we do at home because we don't have a hydraulic juicer, is something that you blend for about a minute and then you take the fiber, and then you press it and you take the juice out, right? But at home, because we don't have a cold press juicer, the easiest way to juice is again, the mortar and pestle. So you take, let's say I have spinach leaves, I have dodapatra, I have tulsi, and I can take a little bit of moringa powder because I don't have fresh moringa. And I can take a little bit of chachika namak, and I can take a little bit of peppermint because I want peppermint for my digestion, and put it in a mortar and pestle with a little bit of water, blend it for about 1 minute or so, and then take the fiber and press it and then the juice comes out into a glass, and that is the best and the most potent juice you could give to yourself.
Okay. All right. Gulu Advani says, can we contact you for further information?
Of course. Yeah.
Yes. Very much. She's also part of Ritambara, and she's our chief nutritionist on Ritambara. We'll make sure that you can get in touch with her. Abhay Mishra says, can you give some more examples of fermenting the everyday food items?
One second. Can you see this?
Yes.
So this is lacto-fermented radish and carrot, which is fermented for about 4 days. And after 4 days, you have to open the jar and see if it's too sour. If it's too sour, that means you can't have it. But you should get it to a point when it's not too sour and shift it to the refrigerator. And this is edible, and it's got the great microbes that we're looking for our gut. Another example is again a combination of vegetables. You have beetroot, you have cabbage, you have I've put a combination of spices with this: pepper, salt, ajwain, kalonji, and I've let it soak for about 4-5 days, and then I'll smell it. If it's not too sour, then it's great, and I'll shift it to the refrigerator, and then I'll start having it for, so it stays in the refrigerator for a period of 10 to 2 weeks, and you lacto ferment it for about a day or two or three, depending on your taste, like how you do with kimchi or sauerkraut.
Just one question I have for you. When you said lacto fermented, what exactly have you put into that jar? What is the liquid?
It's a salt water brine.
That's it.
Yeah.
And you said that after a couple of days, you smell it and you taste it and see if it's too sour, then you can't use it?
Yeah. So the marker is the first thing about fermentation is it's like acquired, it's like wine making, it's acquired practice. You fail a couple of times, and you have to fail because you won't learn otherwise. And after failing a couple of times, you realize this is the kind of sour you want, or this is the amount of fermentation you need for yourself. It's again a practice which will, the more you do it, the more you learn about. So for dosa batters it's again a very basic science, right? We ferment dosa batter between 8 hours to 12 hours to 20 hours. So if I do a simple combination of a whole ragi, if I combine ragi with whole ragi, so ragi is not powdered, it's a whole grain, right? It's got all the right calcium, amino acids, everything intact. I take a half a cup of ragi, I take 1 cup of rice, I soak it for about 3 hours, and then I mix it in the grinder with methi seeds, and I ferment it for about, let's say, 1 day. And then I smell it and I taste it, and I find it's fine. I can take it. And if I want it even more deeper, then I keep it for 2 days. So I'm used to keeping it for between 2 days and 3 days. But the ID dosas, the ID dosa batters are fermented between 8 hours to 10 hours. And I feel you could go more with time. Because again, that's a matter of preference. I like it super fermented. Somebody may not. Somebody would like it just the way it is, just the way ID batters. It's again, you have to try and test it.
It's a matter of taste then for fermenting.
Matter of taste. It's a matter of how many microbes you want at the end of it. I guess.
So the more fermented it is, the more microbes are there. Is that what it is? Okay, fine.
Good bacteria.
Okay. Got it. All right. Rashmi Munshi wants to know, what do you suggest for autoimmune disease, rheumatoid arthritis, and MS?
Oh my God. Okay. That's like a host of things. Autoimmune disease is something, it's like a science again. And there are various protocols to be observed for autoimmunity. One is, of course, that it's not just diet. It's the lifestyle you lead. And I feel the most important thing along with diet is dealing with chronic stress, because that is the most difficult part of autoimmunity. Because we can't handle stress, because we can't handle simple environmental triggers around us, our brain, which is connected to our gut, gets it starts tingling. And there's a deep science behind it, because there's this thing called the vagus nerve, which connects the gut to the brain, which is why we feel a migraine is coming on when we have an abdominal problem or a gastric problem. We feel a pain at the back of our head. It's because there's a connection between the gut and the brain. So I think the most important thing to do with autoimmunity is to keep our stress levels down. And that again is a work, everyday work, which means that I do 1 hour of walk in the nature. I do 1 hour of meditation. It could be singing meditation, drumming, dancing. I do 1 hour of something that I love to do, which is working with clay or playing with kids or going and watching the sunset every evening. I think those are more important than diet, really, because the studies on diet do show that yes, autoimmune reversal is possible with a 100% whole grain plant-based diet. It's possible. But the whole grain plant-based diet means that you have to follow it for a good period of 6 months to see a little bit of change. You know, just like in Ayurveda, if you want to have Shatavari or Ashwagandha or Neem, for instance, if you want the results to show, you have to have it for a minimum of 3 months. That is a given. So with autoimmunity, again, if you desire to see some results, you have to follow a protocol for a long period of time, whether it's to do with Ayurveda or naturopathy, or you want to just have home food, follow it without disturbance, along with a holistic lifestyle, I feel that it's possible. Then again, for arthritis, there are various herbs like shallaki, and there is giloy. Giloy is great. Just have fresh giloy juice first thing in the morning, or if not, have a giloy pill, which is available in the Ayurvedic stores. And again, foods which are dense in calcium, which are rich in a host of phytonutrients, is what we should have for arthritis. Multiple sclerosis is a topic I'm not familiar with, so I'm not, I don't think I can talk about that.
Okay. Ramchandran ji says, understand jackfruit powder is good for diabetes?
Yes.
Okay.
Yeah. So jackfruit there's now science that says that raw jackfruit, more than ripe jackfruit, is medicinal because it helps to reverse diabetes. It puts your GI down over time, and it gives you the right amount of nutrition that a diabetic patient needs for your proteins, your amino acids, your fiber. It has all the, it's almost like a super fruit in that sense, not just for diabetics, but also for like normal humans who need superfoods in their life.
Okay. So there are Rajshekhar ji and Rashmi and all are commenting on how nice the presentation and informative. Vijay Lakshmi Mangal says, sprouted seeds and then freeze it, it will reduce the nutrition. Will it not reduce the nutrition?
Oh no, it's the opposite. Like I was showing you the picture of Avari Bale. We are traditionally used to sprout moong dal, chana, and we are used to sprouting certain things in our kitchen. But you can sprout rice, you can sprout a grain, any grain, you can sprout vegetables, you can sprout just about anything. And the reason sprouting is 10 times more powerful than the normal methodology of consumption is because it, again, the enzymes are bioavailable. The nutrition is way more denser. and it's going to be assimilated into your gut way easier. So sometimes, like if I sprout aware bale, I don't need to cook it. You can just have it raw with salt or lemon, just as it is, like moong sprouts, correct? If I sprout bajra or ragi, all I need to do is put some herbs and spices and consume it. If I don't like it raw, I can dehydrate it, sun-dry it, and mix it with a salad, and your meal is done. So yeah, sprouting is a huge, it's like a vast subject.
True. And we could, her question was, if you freeze it, will it destroy the nutrition?
No. So if I sprout, let's say I sprout moong for about 2 days, and it's freshly sprouted, and I shift it to the freezer immediately, there will be no loss of nutrition, because at minus 18 degrees, your enzymes and your all the living enzymes in it is maintained at the same temperature till you take it out. It's like the saffal mutter. Why is the saffal mutter so unique and convenient? Because they take a single mutter and they freeze it. It's called single cell freezing. And then they put it into packets, and then it's distributed to us. And therefore, it's as fresh as seasonal mutter.
Oh, I didn't know that. Okay, thank you. Juicing leaves, do the pesticide residue get included? I guess you have to buy organic, right?
Well, if you can't buy organic, you can just soak your vegetables in a little bit of salt and nimbu for about 5 minutes. Or if you're still scared, you can blanch your greens. You can blanch it in a steamer for like 30 seconds and take it off and put it in a cold, ice cold bath. So that still retains your nutrition. And then you can juice it.
Okay.
But just grow your own food, and you don't need to think of pesticides.
That's true. That's very true. Prem, will you take over the questions, please?
Okay. Yeah.
Thanks. Yeah. Thank you.
Okay, I'll do it. I think next question is on adding tamarind juice to fresh salads. Is it good or not?
Of course. Why not? If you have fresh tamarind imli.
Yes.
Imli. Yeah. If you love tamarind, and tamarind has unique qualities. It helps in digestion. It keeps your gut microbiome intact. You should just go for it.
Okay. Good. The talk is awesome and motivating comments. Thank you very much. Perhaps you could give your mobile number. I think as part of the Ritambra, we will include your link and the contact details so that people can get in touch with you directly. We'll arrange for that.
Yes.
Veena is asking something about kanji. I'm not sure what exactly you mean by that. Is it the porridge kind of thing that we eat? Are you saying, is it good or bad? Veena, if you want, you can unmute and ask.
Yeah, I was just mentioning that kanji is like a probiotic drink, yes. The one that she was showing for the beetroot and the carrots that I actually make sometimes, and you know,
yeah,
just
yeah.
That information.
No, of course, definitely. I mean, we've been doing this for years in India, and we should continue doing it. I mean, it's more potent, and it's anti-aging, and it has the right enzymes and microbes to, you know, build our immunity, to help our digestion, which is very important for our everyday living. So yeah, we should do it every day. We should do kanji, and we should do whatever is part of our traditional recipes. I mean, our household recipes.
Divya says, fabulous session. Vijayalakshmi is asking, do you recommend refrigerated food?
No, refrigerated food. We do refrigeration because we are living in the city. We don't have time. That's why we do refrigeration. But if I was living on a farm and you were living on a farm, you would have fresh farm food, and you wouldn't need a refrigerator. The reason we use it is because we buy in bulk and we like to store it. But when we put a bunch of spinach into the refrigerator chiller, there is a loss. There will be a loss, 60% loss of the phytochemicals, because it keeps dying. I mean, every day after you harvest the plant, it keeps dying, which is why the stress on living foods. So if I harvest the spinach today and I have it within the next 2 days, it is still a potent plant phytochemical. But if I take the spinach and I buy it from the supermarket, which has already been lying in the supermarket for 3 days, and I take it and I put it in my chiller for another 3 days till I plan to have my spinach meal, it is dead spinach. It is almost as good as having fiber without the nutrition. So it's best if you don't put it in the chiller. You can put it in a jar of water if you want to preserve the nutrition after you get it from your supplier. This is the best way of preserving it. And Bangalore, the temperature is just right for keeping it out on the table or kitchen platform.
Okay, next, is this presentation available on YouTube channels? Yes, I think whatever we conduct our webinars, they're all available on YouTube channels under Ritambara banner. So we will share the link with you. A lot of thanks for the useful information. What do you suggest for people who suffer from migraine?
Oh yes, migraine is something even I have battled with for a long time. And surprisingly, the best solution that I have found for migraine, it is external, it is not food. Because food, again, you know, different people have different biochemistries, and what works for me may not work for you. But the best solution that I found is lavender. The lavender flower, you get an essential oil of lavender and you take a diffuser and you put a couple of drops of lavender and you inhale it. Just like how you have a eucalyptus steam inhalation when you have a cough and cold, you inhale the lavender and you do it for about 30 minutes or so, and you will knock out and sleep for about 12 hours.
What lovely suggestions, thank you, messages. And is there anything which can help with high ESR levels?
Could you repeat what that is?
Is there anything which can help with high ESR levels?
What is ESR? I don't know.
Navita Singh, maybe you want to unmute and ask. Navita Singh, are you there? You can unmute and ask. Okay. While we wait for it to come, we will go to the next one. Very interesting and innovative approach to our food. Thanks. Brilliant. Thanks for sharing useful insight. Thank you, messages. Hope to be part of your session again soon. Wish to learn more. How do you sprout, how to do bean sprouts?
I can't hear you.
Yeah, we are not able to hear the questions. Please speak a little louder.
Yeah, can you hear me now?
Yeah.
Okay. The question is, how do you sprout beans?
Just like Avari Bale picture that I've shown, you soak it in water for 12 hours. And then after 12 hours, you take a muslin cloth or a cloth channi, and you put the beans in the channi, and you have a vessel of water below it. You cover it and you keep it in a relatively, where there's no sunlight, and it will sprout in about 24 hours. And if you want to have longer sprouts, you should keep it for 2 days. But you have to keep changing the water, and you have to flush the beans with fresh water so that there are no microbes sitting on the beans. We could do a long session just on sprouting, and I'd be happy to demonstrate that to you in detail.
Okay. On ESR, somebody has mentioned that it is erythrocyte sedimentation rate marker of acute inflammation.
Inflammation is something that can come down again gradually over a long period of time if we have the right herbs. And the herbs for inflammation again are turmeric mixed with pepper, because it makes it more bioavailable in our gut. If we have turmeric and pepper added, if you make a decoction of pepper and turmeric, or we also make strategies to have turmeric as a pill and have turmeric as a drink and put turmeric into our foods. We are countering inflammation on various levels. There are a vast array of herbs for inflammation, but the best and the most easiest to deal with is turmeric and pepper. So we can just make a kada, we can make a paste with turmeric and pepper and add a little bit of ginger and rock salt and just consume it by a spoon, or we could add it into our sambars and chutneys and vegetables. And yeah, we have inflammation being tackled as we have each and every meal.
Okay. Thank you so much, ma'am. But I have another question. I'm Navita. I asked this question regarding ESR. Ma'am, I just want to know, in case I have high BP issue as well, so is it okay to consume turmeric and the other ginger and whatever you said, pepper?
Yes, absolutely. It does not affect blood pressure. It does not affect blood pressure in any way.
Okay.
In fact, there are studies that show that it helps with getting blood pressure down. And there are studies, I could send you the studies. So you shouldn't be scared of turmeric in any way.
Okay. The next is anything to replace.
That's fine. Thank you so much, ma'am. Thank you.
Another thing for inflammation is that if you shift to a millet-based diet, so this is ragi in flake form, ragi millet, nachni, or what is ragi called in Kannada?
I understand, ma'am. We get our ragi atta here very easily.
Yeah, so you switch to foods that will keep your inflammation in control, and you won't have to think twice. So switch to millets. You have the vitamins, minerals, and the fiber and the calcium. And okay. It is not inflammatory as atta or chawal or, your other cereal. Right.
Okay. Thank you. Thank you, ma'am.
Next question is on anything to replace coffee or tea.
Yeah, coffee replacement is, again, the need for having coffee is because we want to have something warm in the morning. And the easiest, of course, is available around you. Everybody's the shops and supermarkets are filled with coffee. But if you want a coffee replacement, you'll have to work hard at creating. You have to make a mixture of herbs and spices, which, again, creates a coffee stimulation. So I would suggest like cinnamon, nutmeg. You make a kada with cinnamon, nutmeg, chicory root, and a little bit of, to give the bitterness, you can add a little bit of neem, and you boil the concoction and add jaggery if you want something sweet. Add a little bit of, if you want the creaminess, coconut milk or whatever milk that you like, and drink it warm. So that is one. The second is, you've heard of cacao bean, from where we make chocolates. So cacao bean, again, is an antioxidant, and it is very close to or similar to notes of coffee. So you take cocoa and you take cinnamon and you take a little bit of coconut sugar, and you make a concoction again with water, and you drink it. And it obviously is not coffee, but it's quite close to coffee.
Okay, next is Srikant wants to know how to detox the body on a regular basis.
Detox the body? it's like a huge, a huge science, because our body detoxes itself normally on its own every day. When we go to the toilet every day, we are detoxing. When we are, doing oil pulling, or when we are trying to clean our tongue, we are detoxing. So there is detoxing happening every day. But if you want to do a serious detox, which means you want to cut your carbs, you want to cut your coffee, you want to cut all your triggers, chai, coffee and disturbances, then I suggest you go in for a sattvic 21-day program, which means that you cut off all kinds of masaledar and oil and fried and stick to basics like Ayurvedic khichdi and raw food, fresh, vibrant raw food. And you will see by day three changes in your immune system. Your skin will start glowing. You start juicing thrice a day. Your energy levels will go up. So wheatgrass, pineapple, neem, moringa, tulsi, giloy, turmeric, methi. You should make friends with all these guys. And there is a very nice powder which is available if you want to go on a herbal detox. The powder is a combination of, it helps with increasing your metabolism and digestion, and you should have it first thing in the morning. It's a combination of, again, 14-15 herbs, and you just have to suspend it in a glass of water and drink every day. So if you want links to that powder, I could send it to you. It's basically got licorice, ginger, long, cinnamon, muleti, all these kind of herbs, along with turmeric. And you just have it every day in the morning, along with veggies and fruits and Ayurvedic khichdis, and you're on a detox.
Okay, one more point on this coffee is, can coffee be replaced with roasted chickpeas? This gives the exact flavor of coffee.
Yeah, I mean, you know, the chickpea, when we cook the chickpea, the water, it's called aquafaba, that water in which we cook the chickpeas. So that water could be a coffee replacement liquid. So what you can do to that water is you can add your herbs and spices, you can heat it and you can blend it and just glug it. I'm not sure the taste will be very coffee-like, but it'll be quite close.
Yeah, so can I interrupt? Shrikant here.
Yes, go ahead.
Yeah. So this coffee, actually, we were trying from last couple of months. So it's a chickpeas by roasting it and then grinding it. This exactly gives the coffee flavor, and even the taste also resembles the coffee. So this is really working for us. So I just want to share that.
I'm sure, I mean, if it's working for you, then it's awesome. And I'm sure you should market this product and sell it. And don't tell anyone that it's chickpeas.
Yeah. Actually, we have done the same thing with our neighbors also. They couldn't find out, but later once they realized, they were really surprised. So I don't know why it has not come out till now. So it was really surprising for me also. It's a very simple tip, but it's really working. Yeah. Thank you.
I think the thing with coffee, especially in South India, is that because it's locally available, and in the morning you need this jump start, you want this rush, you know, and you want to get going on your laptop or taking care of your business or minding your work. So we are dependent on beverages for that reason. And these beverages are just like addictions, habits, you know, and like how we are addicted to a chai or a coffee. And there is nothing wrong with a chai or coffee, I wouldn't say that, but it's just that if you're battling certain chronic ailments or you have certain issues, then it's advisable to, like if you're on a detox, it's advisable to not have coffee and tea because it creates acidity in the body. But yeah, I mean, there are options, herbal options. In fact, if you look around, you'll find lots of herbal solutions, and like you found the chickpea solution, which mimic the same action of what a coffee does when it goes inside your body. So yeah, that's what is important, to find that beverage.
Okay, I think that's it. I think there are no more questions. Now, one thing I wanted to ask you is, in your diet, you mentioned that oil-free and there's no intake of oil to the body in your diet, whatever you have mentioned so far. So isn't oil a necessary requirement for the body constituent?
So yeah, we were discussing with reference to either autoimmunity or a chronic illness. For a normal human being, fat is very important, and oil and fat are the same thing. And the more we get oils from sources we can trust, whether it's coconut oil. In South India, it'd be coconut oil or gingerly oil. Or North India, it would be mustard oil or sesame oil, groundnut oil. So the more we have access to suppliers who are not killing the oil by overheating it and processing it, the more we should go for such oils. So yeah, oils are very important, but the thing with Indian cooking is we overuse the oil and we overheat the oil. And when we overheat the oil, we are essentially putting bad bacteria, which is getting combined with your vegetables, killing the enzymes and going inside your gut. So we are doing a disservice to ourselves.
Okay, then there's one more question from Radha Raghavan. Wants to know the name of the immune raising product which has 14 ingredients to be taken early morning.
Oh yeah, it's by a brand called Moksham Organic Herbs. It's called a 14-day herbal detox, which could go up to 21 days. And it's available on their moksham.com, M-O-K-S-H-A-U-M, moksham.com. It's a brand from Gujarat. It has basically triphala, licorice, ginger, long, all of these important herbs, cinnamon.
Okay, I think that's it. I think there are no more questions. So thank you, Antara, very much for this interesting session. And on behalf of Ritambara, I really take the opportunity to thank you for conducting the session. And there have been a lot of interesting discussion and question answer sessions. So I hope in the coming future, you'll be conducting more sessions. I think Ritambara will be communicating on these to the rest of the participants. So thank you once again for this interesting session from us.
Yeah, I would also like to end this by saying that since we are doing a series of food wellness webinars, I would like you to also let us know what is it that you want us to do. You want us to go deeper into how to get your gut the healthiest possible, how to ferment food, how to grow food, how to cook without oil, how to use herbs and spices for everyday consumption. What is it, the topic that you would like us to create for you? So it would be nice if you could send us chats or messages and tell us exactly what area in terms of living in Bangalore, what interests you, and we would like to create programs for that.
Sure, okay. Thank you very much. Reshmi, I would like you to
Yes, team G. Thank you, Antara, once again for this wonderful and knowledgeable session on modifying our food habits. I would request all the participants to join us for our two upcoming programs. On Friday, 22nd January, we have a program by Sri Ishwaranji on renunciation. And on Sunday, 24th January, we have a yoga program by Umesh Thagatji starting from 7 a.m. onwards. It's based on boosting your immunity. The details of upcoming programs will be posted on all our social media platforms and groups. Please block your dates for the upcoming webinars. At Ritambara, we look forward to your presence where we bring you interesting topics on holistic wellness arts delivered by a host of distinguished and knowledgeable speakers. Thank you once again to all the participants. Thank you, Antaraji.